So let's see an end-to-end example here. Let us suppose that the machine C wants to communicate with machine D, and subnet is supported by two L2 switches. So there are, you can see there are two L2 switches, the L2 switch on the left hand side and the L2 switch on the right hand side. And you can see that all the machines, machine A, machine E, machine B, machine F, and machine C and A, all are present in the same subnet. What is that subnet? The subnet is 12.1.1.0/24. So you can see all the machines are present in the same subnet, and the subnet is partitioned, or subnet is supported by two L2 switches. So this is how we connect the L2 switch to the machines. Note that all the devices are in the same subnet by inspecting their IP address, and you know all of them have the same network ID, which is 12.1.1.0/24. Tables used in this diagram will be ARP table for devices. So devices means the host machines, that is machine A, machine B, E, F, and C and D. These are called host machines. So here is an empty ARP table for each machine. So we have an empty ARP table for each machine, and we have a MAC table corresponding to two L2 switches. So MAC table for L2 switches and ARP table for host machines. So let us see how ARP table and MAC table together supports L2 routing. So let's say C wants to communicate with D, and subnet is supported by two L2 switches. So what's the first step? In the first step, C wants to send data packet to machine D, and the machine D IP address is 12.1.1.2. So this is user input. So C verifies that D is in its own subnet, right? And how C will verify that D is in its own subnet? By applying the mask value 24 on the D's IP address. You will get the same network ID in which C interface is present. If this condition is true, then C concludes that the IP address 12.1.1.2 to which it is trying to communicate is present in the same subnet. If step 2 validates, C lookup its ARP table with IP address 12.1.1.2 as key. Now at this point of time, the ARP table of C is empty. So C do not have IP address to MAC address table entry for 12.1.1.2 in its ARP table. So it's time for the C to launch ARP broadcast request. So what will be the content of the ARP broadcast request? The source MAC address will be the MAC address of the machine C which is launching the ARP broadcast request. The destination MAC address will be the broadcast address. The source IP is the IP address of the machine C which is launching the ARP broadcast request. And the destination IP address is the IP address of remote machine present in the subnet whose MAC address machine C wants to know. So C launches the ARP broadcast request, that is, it places the ARP broadcast request on the wire. So L2 switch 1, that is the first L2 switch, receives the ARP broadcast request. L2 switch makes an entry in the MAC table. Why it makes an entry in the MAC table? Because L2 switch has received a packet. What kind of packet it is, it doesn't matter. As long as the L2 switch receives a packet which has Ethernet header, it will do MAC learning. So L2 switch inspects the source MAC address in the ARP broadcast request message and the port number on which the message is received. And accordingly, L2 switch makes an entry in the MAC table. So L2 switch 1 reads the destination MAC address, which is the broadcaster address, and hence flirts the ARP request message. Now, after making an entry, the L2 switch reads the destination MAC address, and because the destination MAC address is broadcast address, so L2 switch blindly floods the packet, that is the ARP request message, on all the ports. Now, A and B, that is machine A and machine B, and L2 switch, that is the second L2 switch, 2, receives ARP request message, because the ARP request message has been broadcast by the L2 switch 1. Now machine A and B accepts the packet because destination MAC address is broadcast address. Machine A and B update their ARP table based on source MAC and source IP address in the ARP broadcast message. So remember, ARP table are updated by ARP broadcast message and ARP reply message. In this case, machine A and machine B has received the ARP broadcast message, and hence they will be going to update their ARP table. After updating the ARP table, machine A and machine B discards the packet because destination IP is not equal to IP address of the receiving interface. So note that the ARP broadcast message is discarded by the network layer, that is IP layer. So machine A and machine B makes an entry in their ARP table, that is, they have seen packet which has a source IP address 12.1.1.6 and a MAC source MAC address M6. Now similarly, L2 switch 2 receives the ARP request packet and updates its MAC table. It also floods the packet on rest of the ports. Why it floods the packet? Because the ARP request message is a broadcast message. So you can see that the L2 switch has updated its MAC table with the same entries as that of the MAC table, but in this example, or in case of L2 switch 2, the receiving interface is a P1 interface, so outgoing port is P1. Now machine EFD receives ARP request packet. Why they receive? Because the L2 switch also broadcasts the ARP request message on all the outgoing ports. So machine E, D and F receives the ARP request packet. E and F updates their ARP and eventually discards the packet. Like A and B did, E and F also updates their ARP table and eventually they discards the packet. So they make an entry in their ARP cache or ARP table. D also updates its ARP table but replies with ARP reply. Why D replies with ARP reply? Because the condition that the destination IP address in the ARP broadcast message is equal to the IP address of the receiving interface of the machine which is receiving the ARP broadcast message. So machine D also populates its ARP table, but it replies with the ARP reply. So what are the contents of the ARP reply message? The ARP reply will contain source MAC address as MD, destination MAC address as MC, source IP address as 12.1.1.2, and destination IP address as 12.1.1.6. L2 switch 2 receives ARP reply. Again, it updates its MAC table. So because L2 switch has received the ARP reply from the machine D, it has seen that the source MAC address MD in the ARP reply, and this message has been received on port P3. L2 switch also reads the destination MAC address, which is MC, and forwards the packet to port P1 because it has an entry in its MAC table for MAC address MC. So ARP reply message is forwarded to L2 switch 1 by L2 switch 2, based on the destination MAC address in the ARP reply message. The destination MAC address in the ARP reply message is MC, and the L2 switch 2 already has an entry. It knows that when it receives a packet with destination MAC address is equal to MC, it has to forward the packet out of the interface P1. So ARP reply message now is received by L2 switch 1 from port P6. L2 switch 1 receives the packet and it again does the MAC learning, because the source MAC address in the ARP reply is MD and it has received this packet, that is the ARP reply, from port P6. L2 switch 1 forwards the packet to port P8 because it already has an entry for destination MAC address specified in the ARP reply packet, which is MC. So L2 switch 1 receives the packet and does MAC learning. L2 switch 1 forwards the packet to port P8 using the existing MAC address table entry in its MAC table. C receives the ARP reply and updates its ARP table. Now C can send the packet to D because now C has resolved the ARP. That is, C now knows the MAC address of the destination machine with which it is trying to set up the communication. And in fact, machine D also knows the IP address to MAC address mapping for machine C. So machine C and D now knows the IP address to MAC address mapping for each other. So now C and D can set up the bi-directional communication. So you can see in this entire process, the ARP broadcast message and the ARP reply message has helped to populate the MAC address table, the MAC table entries of L2 switches, as well as ARP table entries of rest of the nodes which are connected to the same subnet. Because any packet placed by any machine on a subnet is heard by rest of the machines present in the subnet. Now let us suppose when the ARP table and the MAC table of L2 switch as well as the host machines are fully populated, as shown in the diagram, after a complete cycle of ARP broadcast message from machine C to D and the ARP reply message from machine D to C,